Namaste, Suprabhatam, everybody in the Americas. Good evening to people in Bharat and good day to everybody else around the world. Welcome back to another episode in our Google Hangout series of OVBI. We have been doing a series of Hangouts leading up to the International Yoga Day, and this is the fourth one. I am happy to introduce today Yogashree N.V. Raghuram ji. He is the spiritual founder and chairman of Yoga Bharati. He is currently professor of Yogic Sciences with Swami Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhana Samsthana, which is also known as SVYASA. It is near Bangalore in India. And he teaches Yogasana, Pranayama, Dhyana, and the cure for various ailments like arthritis, asthma, stress management, along with a complete theoretical yogic and scientific background through lectures. Shri Raghuramji is trained under some of the most renowned exponents of yoga in India and has been practicing yoga for more than 30 years. He has traveled to several countries including Germany, Austria, Switzerland, England, USA, Asia, Malaysia, and many other countries around the world teaching yoga and yoga therapy. So we are very lucky to have him with us today. Please help me to welcome Shri N.V. Raghuramji. And before we go ahead with talking to Raghuramji about the state of yoga around the world, about Karma Yoga and Seva, we'll have Mehulji from OVBI who will give us an introduction to OVBI and the work we are doing as well as the events that we are having around International Yoga. Mehul?
Yeah, thank you, Arvind. We have a small presentation for all of you to see what OVBI is about. Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay. So Overseas Volunteers for Better India is about making the India of your dreams and also enriching the lives of NRIs around the world. It was launched in 2013 to reconnect Indians worldwide, and many NRIs have come forward. Our mission is to build a better India that's culturally rooted, economically advanced, and get more people aware of the national issues and also mobilize a large pool of volunteers we have around the world. It was started by Sri Sri Ravi Shankar in India as a way to relieve India of many of its problems, and he advocated that youth and citizens must take charge. We have the entire speech out here on this link out here. And we have to increase the Indian pride about many of the things India is good at, which is Ayurveda, music, food, tradition, and tourism. And then take responsibility and charge of things. So NGOs along with the government can help make the nation a better. And a better India is better for the world. Our amazing team of volunteers around India did 1,000 projects in various categories in several villages. It was a very amazing feat. Like one of the examples was many rivers were dry. So a few rivers in Maharashtra and Karnataka, volunteers got together and tried to, you know, store water so that the water doesn't just run off after the rains. And this really helped the farmers. In many other cities in India, for example, Mumbai, we took up stand for women's safety, for better traffic, cleaning up railway stations. Even in the Uttarakhand floods, OVBI volunteers are one of the first to reach out there. And even the paramilitary forces applauded our efforts. This was one of the amazing things that came out from volunteers in the US. Many people from big companies joined hands to make a mobile and a web portal so that people can register. So this really increased this helped increase the voting percentage, along with all the efforts of VBI in India. Their volunteers, you know, got together in schools, on the streets to encourage people to vote. And we were also mentioned in a former election commissioner's book. The website was indiavoting.org. This is the award that the President Abdul Kalam is giving some of our volunteers for all the efforts that we did around the nation. And even our OVBI efforts are recognized within US. We have recognition from California, yours, and also New Jersey. From our educational initiatives, we think education is very important so that people get the learn the real Indian history and the culture and heritage, and it increases the Indian pride and what we think of ourselves. So we had a lot of online seminars about the history, geopolitics, current affairs. We encourage you to go to that website, knowourindia.org, so that you can get an idea of that. We had classes to teach Sanskrit and Vedic mathematics, and showcasing contributions by Indian scientists, mathematicians, Bhaskara too. So this is our website. Please go, and there are a lot of videos and quiz and articles and all that. It's very informative. So the other things that we do is that we have a lot of street awareness programs and educational drives around the country, East Coast, West Coast. So these are like enthusiastic volunteers going around and spreading awareness about encouraging people to vote and get together and do projects within the U.S. also. We also provide forum for a lot of Indian leaders, like as you can see, this Rajiv Malhotra, Kiran Bedi, Balasaheb Darade. We invite these people, and also the yoga series that is happening right now, so that they can get a world stage and people can get more ideas and information and inspired from these thought leaders. You had a lot of cultural events around the US also, Diwali, Dandiya, and also Republic Day. We have groups perform and parades and all that. So this really brings NRIs together. We have other projects. We have Adopt a Village. So people go and try to make improvement in villages. This is a very, very interesting effort. And the strength of India is also in the villages. We also donate solar lamps to rural homes because the kerosene has been shown to be not very good for health. So by donating the solar lamps, women can learn, and it improves the productivity of the villages. Bunch of OVA members also went to India to vote in the last elections, take vacation, take time off, and go all the way there to vote. That was very inspiring. They went to various cities in the U.S. and helped on the voting day and also before the voting day to encourage people to vote and direct them to the right voting stations. Now we have AI-powered voter roll cleanup software. So there are many things in the voter database. Some voters don't exist, and there's a bogus voter entry. So we're trying to come up with some algorithms. Our IT team in US, along with the team in India, to help clean up these voter rolls. So helps in the next elections. Good governance is very important at the village level, panchayat level, so that people can make better decisions for the countries. And this school of good governance has been created. And right now scholarships have been given, and so that people can learn better how to be better administrators at the village level, panchayat level. India is a big country. We need big ideas for a better India. So we've had seminars where eminent and thought leaders have come together. In this case, you have Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, Rajiv Malhotra, Naveen Jain, where all these business people come together and see and have conferences and discuss how we can improve India. OVB has also been co-leading and a big partner in many government events. So, Prime Minister Modi's event in New York, we were the largest partner organization. We had a lot of youths come from across the country to join, show hands and support with the new government. And we also handle a lot of the PR media work. And same with this MP, Chief Minister Shivraj Singh from Madhya Pradesh. We got a lot of investors out here to meet with the government officials and see how we can make India better. This is a project to help at-risk kids in Calcutta, so they don't become a sex worker. And so we had a lot of money raised, over $100,000, to build schools for these young kids so that they can have a better future. All this information is on our website, and you can also donate to many of our projects. Right now, in just about a month, we have the first International Yoga Day. Yoga has been shown to improve your health, your vitality, also help with a better community, reduce conflicts. It is so apt that the United Nations has supported this, and over 150 countries have signed this first International Yoga Day. So we are looking forward to it, and this yoga series is part of it. We encourage you to have a yoga event in your city. All the information is out there, and you can register yourself at intyogaday.com. So in short, we encourage people to become a member. It is free on our website. Take up any project and cause that that you like, or you can also work with us and make new projects and create a network wherever NRIs in the world you are. We encourage you to come together. So in the quote for Gandhiji, be the change you wish to see in the world. OVB has been on the forefront and one of the fastest growing NGOs, where we take on a lot of projects to improve the life of the NRIs and also make India a better place. And with that, want to take sure back to Arvind. So thank you very much, Arvind, for about this OVBA presentation, giving us the chance to talk about OVBA. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Mehul. I hear a echo. Do you want to mute yourself?
Yes.
Okay. I think it sounds okay now. Welcome, Raghuram ji. So we'll start off with probably one of the more difficult questions. The question is, what exactly is yoga? If you had to define yoga in a couple of sentences, how would you define it?
Patanjali gives us a very good definition of yoga. It is chittavritti nirodha, that means calming the mind. But he adds to that, tatha drashtuhu swarupi avasthanam. That means you go back to your nature. Swarupa is our own nature. So that means basically yoga is a conscious journey to come back home or homecoming. That's what is basically the definition of yoga at all these personality levels. Like, for example, what is our original nature at the body level is to be relaxed. At the prana level, it is to be slowed down. At the mind level, it is the calm state of mind. And wisdom is the nature. And emotional balance at the deeper level. So yoga is a conscious journey to go back to these things. And that's what Patanjali also used the definition. At the body level, when you relax consciously, it has to come. And that's what he calls it as asana. The practice of asana in yoga is supposed to consciously relax you, going back to your nature. Similarly, at the prana level, a conscious process of slowing down the prana is pranayama. That's why it is given the definition as shwasa prachwasa gatir vichedaha. Gati means speed, vichedaha, cut down the speed. Similarly, meditation is a conscious process of calming down the mind. And jnana yoga is to see that we remove all the wrong fixations in our intellect and then go back to the wisdom. And emotional level, bhakti yoga helps us to go back to our nature. This way, when we set ourselves in the normal nature of ours and then do the activity, and that's what is basically karma yoga. In this way, all the techniques of yoga are essentially helping us to go back to our nature, our swarupa, which is supposed to be the divinity. As Swami Vivekananda said, each soul is potentially divine. And we go to that state. That is the definition of yoga.
Very nice. That was very beautiful. So when we think of Hatha Yoga, which is what most of the people, when they think of yoga, they think of Hatha Yoga, which is the physical yoga exercise. So that itself seems to be something different or special about this physical exercise from all the other types of physical exercises that people might do around the world. And just doing those physical exercises seem to have not only an effect on the body but also on the mind. So what is different about the yoga postures or the Hatha Yoga system compared to other physical exercises that it would have this kind of beneficial effect?
Actually, when you look at the word Hatha Yoga, it comes from the word Hatha Yoga Pradipika, which is a text written by Swatmarama. And while writing the text, Swatmarama says, this Hatha Yoga Pradipika is supposed to subserve the ideas of Patanjali's Anga Yoga or Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. So therefore, this Hatha Yoga is something which should really enhance the benefits or the approach of whatever that Patanjali has given us in the form of Yoga Sutras. It is understandable because Patanjali did not spend too much time explaining about what are the asanas, explaining about pranayama. He gave the definitions. And Samarama gives us the details about what are the practices of asthanas, what all practices of pranayama and kriyas, vandhas and all those things, he said. But ultimately, Swatmarama says, Hatha Yoga is supposed to subserve the Raja Yoga proposed by Patanjali. Now, the question of the benefit of Yogasanas or ideas of yoga over the physical exercise. When God has given us this body, the body is supposed to do the physical activity. Like when he gave us the legs, we wanted to walk. When he gave us the joints, he wanted us to use the joints by sitting and getting up and all that. Earlier, people used to do all these things, so naturally the body was fit. But slowly what happened with the technology that has come up, unfortunately what happened was that we have slowly given up all the activities we were supposed to do it. As a result of it today, that we have removed all those physical exercises in our day-to-day life, which was normal in our case. Therefore, we really require some form of physical exercise to be introduced in the way of life. This is what is basically necessary for our lifestyle. But this is different from yoga, because exercise is something which is the body is supposed to do the activity, and which anyway the body is doing by either earlier it used to be in the form of lifestyle, or today it is in the form of these physical exercises at gym and all that we do it. But yoga is supposed to be something which is supposed to relax, so which is supposed to be in the opposite direction. And there is very important idea about this relaxation about yoga, that normally that we have three different types of relaxation. One is that people use substances and external agency for relaxation. It no doubt relaxes, but only is that the side effects and all those things so much that the relaxation is just only 2-3%, but the effects, the wrong effects is so big. Whereas sleep is another way of relaxation. A lot of studies have been done, and sleep gives about 7-8% reduction in the stress level for 6 hours of sleep. But yoga, we have studied, shows that it gives almost like 24-28% reduction in stress level. So which means yoga is the only technique where consciously you relax. Therefore, these are the two important components of the field of yoga. One is you need to have awareness, which physical exercise does not make it as a mandatory thing. Yoga, you need to have your awareness while doing yoga. Second is the relaxation, which is not mandatory in the case of physical exercise. When these two components are added in our way of life, that's where basically that yoga has a benefit of it. All these people who go for athletics and all those things, they have to do the workout essentially, which is necessary for one to develop the stamina, etc., all those things. But together with that, we also have to have relaxation, so that relaxation will help us to go to a deeper level of our perception. Now, there are some questions which appear here on the screen. That is, Mehal wants to ask next question, what is Yoga Bharati? What does it do? Let me give some background about the university, Swami Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhana Samsthana, SVYASA University, which is basically doing the most fundamental research in the field of yoga, its application, the form of therapy and management, etc. And this city is located in Bangalore. And they are doing a lot of work and a lot of research work is there. There are about 500 students who are doing various activities right up to PhD level. Now, this message of this particular university information is taken to the world around by various organizations, and one of the foremost organizations which takes this message is Yoga Bharati, which is based in USA, but has the centers in Turkey and Germany and other places. So to just disseminate the message of YASA, which is basically yoga as a science, and that's what we are being taken towards that particular thing. And that's my answer for that. Thank you.
Okay. So you said Yoga Bharati takes the message. Yoga Bharati conducts yoga sessions, classes, and events around the world. Is that what Yoga Bharati does?
Yes, Yoga Bhakti basically conducts the yoga classes, yoga therapy classes, and yoga therapy consultation. We have trained people who are trained in the field of yoga therapy, doctors. We also try to connect with the people in India so that this consultation will be effectively done, so that therapy classes go on. Apart from that, we also do what is called as Yoga Teacher Training Program, which is RYT 200 and all that. Then also we do a training program for PGDYT, Postgraduate Diploma in Yoga Therapy, and also for distance education, Master's in Yoga and Bachelor's in Yoga, when we conduct classes in Yoga Bharati for such students from outside. And also we try to liaison people who are going for some, whether it is, that is Vyasa University, Yoga University, for the therapy or for doing any courses, Yoga Bharati liaisons between Vyasa and the people outside so that their stay there comes comfortable.
Okay. So as part of your work with Yoga Bharati, you have traveled around the world to many different countries.
Right.
Can you tell us a little bit about your experience seeing yoga practice around the world, how yoga is being practiced in different countries, if there are any variations to how yoga is being practiced around the world, how popular it is. Can you tell us about the state of yoga around the world?
Yeah, in the last 20, 30 years, the development of yoga around the world, when you look at it, basically there are two, three teachers who have really prepared yoga teachers from various parts of the world. They are Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, and then also that Patabi Joyce in Mysore, and B.K. Sayangar, and these are the people, and also Shivananda Yogashram. These are the centers who have really prepared yoga teachers, and then these are the people gone around the whole world, and independently they were giving yoga classes. Most of them, they were giving yogasana practices, some of them included some little pranayama and also kriyas and all that. But then Shivananda Yogashram has taken even the bhakti yoga, which is regular chanting and bhajans and all that, to the yoga centers all over the world. So there are individual schools, individual teachers, that they have developed their own yoga centers, which is going on. But in the last about 15 years, then there is a lot of research and also application has developed in the various parts of the world, particularly in several parts in the East European countries, like in Romania, Bulgaria and all that. There is so much of development of yoga that has taken place, that there's a big research that's going on in long time ago, actually, in Czech Republic, Czechoslovakia, that he has been doing, Emil Zatopak and several others. And there's one person who has done the whole of research on the PhD on the Surya Namaskar itself from one of the East European countries like Slovakia or something like that. And in Germany, there's a hospital where yoga therapy has been introduced as a regular medical management for neurological disorders like ataxia and multiple sclerosis and stroke patients. And this is in Greece, which is close to it. So in England, there is a very nice, wonderful yoga organization called Yoga Biomed Service and all that. And they are doing good work of training yoga teachers, yoga therapy teachers. Japan, there is a whole lot of development of yoga teachers and yoga therapy teachers. Almost like 4,000 to 5,000 of them got trained in Japan, various parts of Japan. In Muslim countries like Turkey and also in Iran, there are yoga classes going on, yoga teachers are there, particularly in Turkey, 8 different cities. There's a lot of yoga teachers are developed and they are going on giving yoga to the people. So that way, when you look at it, the all over the world, yoga has become very popular. Recently in China, our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, he has inaugurated a yoga university in one of the Chinese cities. So it has become popular there also. There is so much of research is happening all over the world. We need to really recognize, especially in USA, there's a very high class research is going on in various places in USA, and a lot of non-Indians are actually involved in this research and development of these things. One of the most important research work that is going on is in the field of cancer. MD Anderson Cancer Research Institute, and the cancer project is actually funded by NIH, National Institute of Health, by $4.5 million, and it's on the breast cancer. Now, in a continuation with that, we have taken up a work in the case of lung cancer, which is in collaboration with SVYASA University and MD Anderson Cancer Research.
Okay, very nice. So it looks like every year yoga is becoming more and more popular, and it's being studied more and practiced more around the world. And we have seen another effect also of this, where some of the people take up yoga and give it different names or adapt it to themselves, or even try to patent certain yogic practices. We have also heard of practices like Jesus yoga or Christian yoga and things like that, and we have heard of people patenting certain yoga practices and preventing other people from teaching those practices. So what is your opinion on things like this? Is it okay to do this? Because after all, it is helping to spread the practice of yoga around the world. Or does doing this kind of take some of the core messages away from yoga?
So at three different levels, this whole thing has developed. In the first place, the world did not know what yoga is, and now that has spread, so that I don't have to go around the world and tell that there is something like yoga. All over the world, people know yoga. That first stage is over. Then the teachers who have gone to India and trained in the field of yoga and they started giving yoga, they have taken the yoga just bits and pieces like asanas or some pranayama, or some people take meditation and all that. That was going on. So this is at the second level that this spread has taken place. Now it is the time for us to do two things. One is that we try to give the whole historical background about yoga. In fact, in the last about couple of years, I've been going around Europe and USA and also in other countries in the eastern side, that is China and Japan, Indonesia and all that, where I'm giving 10,000 years of history of yoga with all the evidences. So this way, the history of yoga, when we give them, then they know that how it has been continuously coming from all the time from the culture of India. So nobody can claim the authorship for yoga, because you are giving the whole lot of it, where other cultures do not even know that anything about development, that we have really given the ideas of yoga. So that is spreading. And third important thing, most important aspect in my view, we have to do it is, the science is not based on any particular individual. Science is a science, whether it is Newton's given the ideas of physics or Einstein given the ideas of physics. Physics is physics. Same way, yoga need to be brought out of the clutches of the individuals who claim that they are the people who are yogi, but to a level where it is like a science. So with these evidence-based yoga that we are trying to give, and logical-based explanations of the yoga philosophy that we are giving, whether it is Raja Yoga, Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, all these things when we give logical explanations and all that, now the world is taking this particular message much more seriously. That's one of the reasons why we thought that if the message comes from a university like Vivekananda Yoga University, people ask, is it Vivekananda Yoga? They said, no. Vivekananda is an inspirer, but yoga science, which has come from India, and like a medical university, like an engineering university, this is what is called as yoga university. So we get the message of yoga across. So this way that we give it, I'm very sure next decade, slowly it comes out of the personality cult kind of a thing to a more acceptable science.
Thank you. We have a next question for you, Raghuramji. What advice or tips do you have for people who are new to yoga and want to start a personal practice? So for people who are new to yoga and they want to start, what advice do you have for beginners?
The very first sutra, in the very first chapter that when Swatmarama introduces the ideas of Hatha Yoga, whether it is the practice of asanas or kriyas or bandhas and mudras, he gives that these are all the things which a normal healthy person should be able to do it. So that means to say, you start any yoga center which is nearby and then do the practice of yoga. If you are a healthy person to start with, that's a very wonderful thing, because there is nothing which is more important than the health itself. And if we can maintain the health, which is supposed to be with the help of yoga, that we can treat all kinds of ailments and all that, this itself is a wonderful thing. So let anybody start anywhere in any yoga school to start with the yoga. But when you start actually doing yoga, then actually questions arise within your mind that what next and what is the thing that can take you further. Then your journey is continuous. So a deeper techniques and all the deeper ideas that you can come to institutions like Vyasa, all those things, who give these deeper ideas. Apart from that, if you are sick or something like that, then the tips that we try to give, a very generic idea is that yoga is something to be relaxed, something to be calmed down, peaceful and all that. So naturally, a practice which is straining you, which is creating a problem for you, if 2-3 days you do it, then you will come to know about it. Then you can just continue with that. Get an opinion of an expert so that whether you continue it or is it just only a temporary phase that you have the wrong effects of it or something that you need to really make a correction, you can always do that. And there are yogacharyas, yoga therapy teachers, authentic yoga therapy teachers who are trained in that area. They can always help you.
Nice, thank you. I think you kind of took us to the next question. So there are many people around the world who have been doing yoga for many years. They've been doing mostly probably physical asanas. So if they want to have greater depth and understanding of yoga and integrate it in their lives, the yoga is a way of life. So for these people who've been doing asanas for a long time, what advice or guidance can you have so that they can go to the next stage in the path?
See, Patanjali himself gives us a very beautiful scheme of things about the field of yoga in his Ashtanga Yoga. See, human being is a complex personality. He is not just only physical body, but he is body, mind, consciousness complex. In between, we have also prana, we have also intellect and emotions. Therefore, Patanjali gives us a scheme of things where at the outermost level that we practice the yama and niyama, then we go to the asana at the body level. Then deeper than that is pranayama, and further is meditation, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. Like that he gives us the Ashtanga Yoga. Therefore, we should first of all start with all the necessary steps in the environment. That's what is yama, niyama, we need to do that. There should be an important change in the personality so that shaucha, santosha, tapas, swadhyaya, all these things when we follow, that you are an illuminated personality. Then you do the asanas, and once you are to some degree expert in the asanas, or you are able to maintain your body properly, then you can go to the pranayama, then you go to the meditation. There are a few things that we need to recognize that the grosser practices are at the beginning, the subtler practices as we go ahead further and further. Like asanas is a very gross practice, whereas pranayama is subtle. And then meditation is much subtler practices, especially going into deep into emotions is deep subtle practices of yoga. So this is the scheme of things that we need to go. So the deeper that you go, you really require a proper kind of a teacher whom you need to connect with them. Like for example, if you are going into meditation, taking some mantra, taking some ideas of meditation or jnana yoga, then you really require people who are expert in that field. And you can connect with them so that you can journey further in the field of yoga.
Thank you. That was very nice.
So, Raghuramji, there is another question or request from many people who have been practicing yoga for some time. And personally, I have also seen that as a yoga practitioner, when I give introduction to yoga to people, when I give a demonstration in schools and other places, there is a lot of demand for people to learn yoga. And I am not a certified yoga teacher. I have many friends who are also not certified yoga teachers, but they practice yoga. And we have found that there is a lot of demand, but as we are not trained to be yoga teachers, we are not very confident, or we have some doubts on whether we are teaching it the right way, things like that. So you told us earlier that Yoga Bharati and your SVYASA institution has a course for teachers to get trained to be a yoga teacher. So can you tell us a little bit more about that course for yoga teachers? How long does it take for a yoga practitioner to train himself or herself to become a teacher and certified? Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Under Yoga Bharati, in USA and in Turkey and also in Germany, we are giving the yoga teachers training programs. And you can go to the Yoga Bharati website and look into it. It is not that we regularly, a particular period of time, we have this yoga teachers training. Looking at the local conditions and the availability of people and all those things, that we normally design this program almost like 6 months ahead of time and then make an announcement. It is 200 hours of intense practice of training of yoga that is given by the experts in the field of Yoga Bharati. But finally, the certificate will be given by the Vivekananda Yoga University, because that's what is the tie-up. And it's also acceptable for the Yoga Alliance, that's what is the society in USA, which certifies the certified yoga teachers. Yoga Bharati has mainly this yoga teacher training program going on. One in California, two in California, that is one in Bay Area, other is Los Angeles. And apart from that, we also have it in Michigan State, and a couple of courses we have conducted in Atlanta, Georgia. Apart from that, SVYASA has yoga teacher training program. One is happening in every year, at least one program. Sometimes it is two programs in Houston, Texas. And one thing is in Cerritos in California. So these are the places SVYASA is giving the yoga teacher training program. We also have an associated organization called as Nataraj Yoga Center in Boston. They also give yoga teachers training program, which is certified by Yoga University in Bangalore. Even if you are not trained as a yoga teacher, you can start giving yoga classes personally at individual level, but you can also invite some of the yoga trained teachers in either Yoga Bharati or Vyasa to your place and start initiating the yoga classes. Whatever the training that they give and the type of yoga that they are presenting and all that, if you continue to do at that place, eventually you can develop a small little group of volunteers in that area, and they can take up further yoga teachers training program. When it is done, then the experts come from any of these yoga centers to come and give you the training to become, make you as a certified yoga teachers.
Okay. So this training program is, you said, for 200 hours. So it takes about 5 weeks for a person to attend this training program and get certified?
In the beginning, we have to plan these things in the availability of local time. You know, sometimes that it is only the weekend training program is available, because people can give time only the weekend. Some that they can give a few weekends, but at the same time, at a stretch for 1 week, you go for a retreat kind of a place and all that. So like that, according to the convenience, this can be done. But slowly we are planning to divide this whole training program into modules and say that different modules at different times you can get the training, and then you can combine all of them to have a yoga certification teacher.
Thank you. Raghuram ji, you mentioned earlier about how yoga therapy and yoga can help diseases. We see there's a lot of disease in the world today, like you have high cholesterol, then you have diabetes, you have asthma, psychological problem. Can you elaborate a little bit of how yoga can help with some of these things? Diabetes, cholesterol, you know, they affect so many people and their families also in Korea.
Actually, there was a time when people had problems which are basically because of various influences from outside, like for example some bacteria, some viruses and all those things. But today most of the problems that we have, health issues, are connected with the lifestyle disorders. So therefore basically that the connection, that the remedy for that is not just with the medicine, but it is change in the lifestyle. And yoga is essentially working on the lifestyle. When we give the yoga training, we also give them what should be the lifestyle that you have to adapt it. This is given in Bhagavad Gita, Yukta Ahara Viharasya Yukta Cheshtasya Karmasu Yukta Swapnava Bodhasya Yoga Bhavati Dukkha. The problems of Dukkha, if you want to get out of it, then you need to adapt a lifestyle which is supposed to be yogic way of lifestyle. So a lot of these psychosomatic problems are because that we have a lot of negativity, we have a lot of conflicts that are there, we suss within ourselves, and then we are looking outside as something which is nice and beautiful and all that, but inside there is a lot of conflict that's developing. So when you rightly take yoga, the idea of yoga is essentially is samatvam yoga uchyate. That kind of a harmony that inside that we develop will try to overcome all these conflicts and disturbances that are there. Now this conflict resolution and this inner harmony development, not only it can be done just not by the asanas, but also a proper kind of pranayama practices, and then nice wonderful idea of yoga when we try to take it into our intellect. After all, we are all intellectual beings. So a correction at the intellect level with the yogic ideas, then that will really help us to see that how we can come back to the health. A lot of times we have, you know, in our yoga university, a 200 bed hospital, and the people come with a lot of ailments. Like, you know, it may look to be very physical kind of back pains, and then asthma and diabetes, which are supposed to be very, very physical kind of ailments. But when we talk to them, we see that how much that they are actually suppressing the conflicts and suppressing their emotional disturbances within them. So we try to help them at all these levels in yoga. Therefore, yoga therapy is not just only practicing a few asanas or pranayama, but it is a much deeper integrative work that we are doing. And that really helps a lot. And that is the reason why yoga therapy education becomes a very serious involved kind of a training, not only in the form of learning various aspects of it, but on-hand experience that we can provide at our hospital in Bangalore.
Very nice. It's like that we say that the mind surrounds the body, right? So if you help with the mind, if you help with the mind, you help with the body, right?
Yes. Actually, the medicine has come to a level where they were only thinking of physical. Then they came to what is called as psychosomatic or psychosomatic. And today the most important thing is mind-body medicine. But this mind-body medicine still does not introduce what is called as consciousness behind it. So what yoga practices is one step ahead. It's not just only mind-body, but body-mind consciousness kind of a therapy that we try to give. That's what is the yoga therapy. And that's why we say that this yoga therapy becomes it's hard for the future generations.
Good. Thank you. That's very nice. More and more of the world can become aware of all these benefits of yoga you talk about. Question we have is, are there any adverse effects when you practice yoga? What should people be careful about so that they don't get side effects?
Hatha Yoga Pradipika, who has given us such a physical kind of 84 asanas and all those things he has given, he himself mentions two important checks when you are doing yoga asanas. The physical postures are kriyas and bandhas. He gives us very good two indications of the checks for what we should do. First thing he says that when you practice yoga, it should result into, or you should constantly feel two things. One is vapuhu tanutum vadanam prasannata. That means to say, your face should have not the tense feeling, but it should be so relaxed on the face, it should reflect vadanam prasannata. And then at the body level, it is not the question of knots in the body, but the body should be tanutvam. That means to say, the smooth, and it should be soft like body. You know, I see a lot of time people saying that I practice yoga and showing all the muscles. Yoga is not for building muscle. It is to create a body which is supple and gentle. This is what is basically Swatmarama himself, Hatha Yoga Pradipika, person gives us the caution. The second caution that he gives is, Patanjali gives us, is that prayatna shaitili ananda samapatibhyam. That means to say, a person who practices yoga should lead you toward, the practice of yoga should lead him towards, in any activity that he does, the effortlessness and the smooth flow of an activity has to happen from within himself. Then you are really progressing towards the better way of yoga. If you feel that the body gets knotted up, before even it becomes like pain, the body itself has some indications. Like for example, if you develop giddiness feeling in the body, or a tightness in the body, and third is that losing your balance state, tremors. These are the things which Patanjali also suggests, that these are the indications that there is something wrong going on in the body. Stop the practices, get the proper advice, then you can continue it. Nothing is lost.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome. The very important thing of yoga, yes, come on.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, what I mean to say is that the way that the yogacharyas indicated, yoga is not just 1 hour that you do on the mat, or just half an hour that you sit down and hold your nose and something like that. But it is, your way of life should be yoga. That means to say, any activity that you do should be converted into yoga. This is the most important message that Krishna gives in Bhagavad Gita in the form of Yogastha Kuru Karmani. Do an activity in the field of yoga. That's where the whole large area of Karma Yoga comes into the picture. I just wanted to mention that so you can ask me the question.
Yeah, actually that was a very good lead to my next question, which was exactly about Karma Yoga. So throughout this discussion, you had mentioned different types of yoga, and Karma Yoga was one of them. And doing Karya and Karma is something that nobody can escape from. We all have to do some work, some form of work. So Karma Yoga is supposed to be practice or a state of mind which is supposed to help us do the work in the right way, be more efficient and effective in the work that we do, and also regardless of what results come, it is supposed to help us lead a life of greater happiness and calmness. So can you explain to us a little bit more about the concept of Karma Yoga, which is not easy to grasp? So can you explain to us what exactly is Karma Yoga and how we can work so that our work is in accordance with the concept of Karma Yoga?
Often people say that Bhagavad Gita is the mother, is the basic text about Karma Yoga. It started from there. But I beg to differ a little bit on that, because in the Upanishad itself, Isavasya Upanishad itself, the first sutra, second sutra of Isavasya Upanishad is contributing towards the first concept of Karma Yoga. Kurvanyeneha karmani jijivishet shatam samaha. For 100 years you do the work. And like that, in the Upanishad of Isavasya Upanishad itself, the Karma Yoga hint is given. And it says, but how do you do that? That means basically this karma should not become burden. Nakarma lipyate nare. This is what is the idea that he gives, and Krishna takes the lead from that and gives us the whole idea of the Karma Yoga in Bhagavad Gita. So it is very important to understand that what is the idea of Karma Yoga. The first thing is that Krishna says to Arjuna, you fight the battle in a Karma Yoga way. It means basically it is not to change the activity. The same activity, like Arjuna is supposed to fight the battle, and you do the same activity of fighting the battle, but in a yoga way. What can really make it into yoga? It is not the activity per se, but it is the attitude behind it. I can have an attitude behind an activity where my attitude is constantly fighting with myself. The second thing is I have an attitude where it is in congruence with myself and doing an activity. See, these are the two ways. Like, for example, I have to go to the office and then I keep fighting with that, with my own self, saying that horrible thing. I have to go through this traffic. I have to do this work. I'm so stressed out. You are not stressed out because of the work outside. You are stressed out because you are fighting with your own decision, your own activity. Great people have shown that even though the work they do not agree, but then still they work with a 100% commitment behind that activity. And that's what Bhishma has shown us. He knows very clearly that he is on the side of Kauravas because of some compulsions that he has to be there. And he said this is a wrong battle. But while fighting the battle, he is 100% behind it. So he knows very well that's not the type of work that he is supposed to do it, but then he put 100% behind it. We have such wonderful examples in scriptures to show that how they are not split personality by doing an activity. They are doing 100% that activity. A lot of times what happens with us is we have very fixed notions, is this is the good work, this is bad work. This work I should do, this work I should not do it. This is how we split our personality, and the situation is different, that you are supposed to do an activity. At that time, you are fighting with yourself. You are at war with yourself. This should not happen. A very simple example, I set up the alarm timepiece to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning to go to the work. When alarm goes, I see how many people fight with that alarm. You have not, nobody else set up, nobody decided that you have to get up and go. You have decided. When you decided, be 100% with that. This inner fight, somewhere deep inside, we plant seed in the form of a negativity within myself, a fight within myself. It leaves the seed, percolates itself, and slowly becomes a tree. And that I fight with myself is what is the present day ailment, like cancer, like arthritis. You know, all these autoimmune disorders are supposed to be. The very definition in the medical field, autoimmunity, means you are fighting with yourself. So in Karma Yoga, essentially, see that you avoid all this conflict. One of the best ways to avoid the conflict is you do the work and then give everything onto the divinity, because it is his plans. Whatever that work you are supposed to do, if you are doing it, don't even look at the fruit of action. This is a very beautiful concept that Krishna gives in Bhagavad Gita, that the first split of your mind takes place when the mind is split into one part of the mind doing the activity, another part of the mind is already on the result. He says that karma and karma phala, don't split your mind, because karma and karma phala, they are not different. It is like the way the plant is there and the flower is there. The extension of plant is the flower. Extension of flower is fruit. It's all one. Only we divided that into different parts, and therefore we struggle with ourselves. So this is one of the important ideas that Krishna gives in the Karma Yoga. In fact, in Bhagavad Gita, there are so many such wonderful ideas about Karma Yoga. Surrender to the God. Don't look at the fruit of action. Put your 100% on the work that you are doing. These are all the things which Krishna suggests us.
Well, thank you. That is very nice and very enlightening about how to maybe better the way we live our lives and reduce the disease in our world.
I'll just add one more small thing in this. This concept of seva is very unique in the Indian philosophy. Actually, it is something which is so sacred that seva is as great as the meditation itself. And in fact, it is something which contributes to the meditation very spontaneously. That's what is the idea of seva. We don't have a proper word in English. That's why we translate seva into service. The moment you say service, that means you are doing for somebody. But seva is not you are doing for somebody. Somebody is only the area of operation, but you are doing for yourself. Like, for example, the student does everything to the teacher, not because that he's doing somebody to the teacher. The teacher, him, is like his own wisdom, so much standing there in front of it, and I feel so happy to serve that wisdom. That's what is seva. This beautiful concept of seva we have in such a deep way in the Indian philosophy. That's why I like this idea of seva as a title that we have for any of the activity that we do it. It integrates us in such a way that I feel so humble that, look, you are the head and I am the feet, and the feet is carrying the head, and that's what is the seva.
Thank you. That was very nice. I had a follow-up question on something you said earlier. People spend a lot of time on decision making. How can yoga improve how we make decisions about ourselves and our lives?
At the time of yoga helps us, you know, this way. Whenever if you are practicing yoga, you are almost like 60, 70, 80% of the time you are maintaining your awareness. It's not what postures that you are doing, what pranayama that you are doing. What is more important thing is 70% of your time you are maintaining your awareness. The normal course of time, when you look at it, your awareness is not more than 10 to 2%. 80% of the mind is wandering here and there, thinking that I don't have to put myself here. But yoga helps us to see this way, that you are putting your 100%, 70-80% of the time in the present. This is what Eckhart Tolle says, be in the present. That means at this moment, I am 80% on that. Any decision that you take where you are 70-80% there, that decision is definitely going to be in the right direction. The result, whatever that comes, it helps you to really get more knowledge. If it is a failure or if it is a success, that naturally this decision will take you towards this. Most important aspect is not just only decision making, where now with the help of yoga you are putting 80% of your time, but percent of your awareness. But very important thing is that after you make the decision, then sticking to the decision. Very often what happens is you decide, then later on you keep repenting. Why did I decide like that? Why did I decide? We are not together with our own decision. And this is where basically the conflict occurs within us.
Very nice. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I really loved the things that you told us about seva itself. I am very fortunate to be around people who do seva most of the time. A lot of time I spend with people from different organizations like OVBI, and these people spend a lot of time doing seva. For some of them, it's almost like a first job, and their regular career is like a second job. And I have found that many of these people, especially from organizations like OVBI and Hindu Swayam Sevak Sangh, they also have a yoga practice, a personal yoga practice. And it looks like the yoga practice helps them in their seva work, and the seva work helps them to be better yogis. So can you tell us a little bit more about this integration or this relationship between yoga and seva, and how that can help all our people who are interested in doing more service and more work in the world?
It has much more deeper significance to this idea of yoga and seva, not at a very simple generic level. The idea is yoga means joining. That means to say joining or yoking together. And something like this, look at the simple structure of human body, where extraordinary brilliant brain is yoked with the legs which carry the whole weight of the body. That's all the two things that are there. Very amazing faculty that it is here. So the very fact that this particular yoga is something which is supposed to be totally opposite in character, nothing like that, you are trying to put them together. In seva, that's what happens so naturally, spontaneously. In fact, what happens with us is, like for example, whether it is all these organizations, you see that unconsciously we have great people behind that who are great yogis, but at the same time, they're involved in the simple sense of seva. Like Shishi is a great yogi, but at the same time, a simple way he does into yoga. This is what Krishna said, you don't have to plan it, But it so happens that your psychology is ready for accepting the guidance of the great people. Yadyad acharyate sreshtaha tatra devi taro jana sayat pramanam krute lokastha danvartate. You never see in these people, whether it is Dr. Nagendra or whether it is Sri Sri Ravishankar or Jaggi Vasudev or Amachi, anybody doing such work, but as if while doing the work, they are just doing the work. They never feel that they are yogis behind it. But otherwise, that they are great yogis. So it looks like that seva and yoga, that inseparable, you cannot separate them kind of concepts that we have it in our culture. That's the reason why this culture always said that the sages who are sitting in Himalayas and doing meditation, deep yogis, they are actually sustaining the dharma of this world. And that is what is the seva that they are doing. Visibly, you cannot see the seva, but that's what is happening behind it.
Very nice, Raghuramji. I wish we could talk a lot more about yoga and seva and karma yoga and other aspects. Yes. But we are nearing the end of our time today. So before we close, we wanted to ask you a couple of questions regarding International Yoga Day itself. UN has declared June 21st as the International Yoga Day, and it was proposed by Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi ji. So can you tell us from your point of view as one of the leaders of the world in the field of yoga, can you tell us what should be the vision for what International Yoga Day becomes in this first year as well as in future years? And a lot of people who are involved in this Hangout and who are also watching this Hangout, we are all volunteers who are working on different events for International Yoga Day also. So do you have any advice for us on what we should do to achieve the vision of International Yoga Day?
The government of India has given us a particular plan that what we need to do on International Day of Yoga, IDY, and that plan is something which is available online and which is downloadable and all that. At the first impact, what I would want is that all over the world, that is a vision that they have to see that this particular practice of yoga we do all over the world and create a kind of an awareness in the whole world that we are united. It's not just we are doing yoga, but the world is one unit, universe. That's what we are trying to create, particularly at the time where we have the crisis of divisiveness working in this world. Yoga can be a wonderful uniting force that is there. I happened to go to a Shinto temple in Japan, and I saw that almost like 70,000 people that they are practicing Tai Chi together in the afternoon, one at the 12 o'clock in the midday, doing Tai Chi. It looks so beautiful. And that same picture is there in my mind. If you can see that millions of people all across the globe are practicing this yoga, it looks such a wonderful unification kind of an idea. Once we start developing that, then slowly the world can go towards where you can feel that fraternity and togetherness becomes much more important. You know, fighting the evil forces by an evil may not get the good results that what we think of the divisive forces that are there, but we can combat them with the wonderful pious force or the wonderful spiritual force like yoga. I think definitely the world can be a better place as an answer that we can give to the world's divisive forces these days which are happening. And that's one thing. Second thing is, this year that we have taken up, to see that a practice of yoga to show that the whole world is together, we do it. Together with that, there is another important challenge that we have. It is, the world is going to head into a big crisis with the diabetes. So we have taken up in India a huge movement called as Stop Diabetes. All the organizations, spiritual organizations in India are involved. In fact, Sri Sri Ravi Shankarji is given us blessed with a lot of support and all those things. But this is not just only the problem. Probably in future years to come, we should really come out with such projects not only it will be useful in India, but to see that at a global level, we can take it forward. And yoga is something which can really bring this to the world around.
Yes, thank you very much, Raghuramji. So here we are going to quickly just tell the viewers about the various websites. Yeah, can you see this? This is the Yoga Bharati's website that Raghuramji was talking about, all the various classes they have in various parts of US. And it's a very nice website that you can learn about yoga and take your participation in yoga to whatever level that all the options that they have. Then this is the International Yoga Day website that we invite all of you to organize an event in your city. We are having around 100 cities. We are planning to have a big movement. So this is the time you can do a day in the sun, a day of yoga, a day to improve your life. Get your friends and family, get them started on yoga. So a very nice thing. This is a OVBI website where from here also you can get to the International Yoga Day website, and these are all the current initiatives and events that we sponsor, how you can volunteer, you can join, become a member, and you can donate. And then this is the Know Our India website, where you can learn about various parts of the Indian history, for example, how India really got independence, and many other nice articles out here. So please come for the International Yoga Day. Invite your friends and family. This is a wonderful opportunity not to be missed.
So please add also this SVYASA.org, that is the website of the university, which offers all these courses right up to PhD level.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot, Raghuramji, and thanks a lot, Mehul. It was a really nice conversation that we had today. And just to remind our viewers, you can watch this Hangout as well as our past Hangouts on YouTube at youtube.com/overseasvbi. And in the next 3 weeks leading up to the International Yoga Day, or 3 or 4 weeks, we have more Hangouts planned. Next weekend, we'll have a Hangout with all the different organizations that are involved in celebrating International Yoga Day here in the US with OVBI. We have a Hangout planned with Shri Rajiv Malhotraji in the beginning of, I think it's the first weekend in June. And after that, we have another Hangout with Dr. David Frawley, who is an ordained Hindu sannyasi. His name, Hindu name, is Vamana Shastri. We have a really interesting Hangout coming up with him also. And we'll also have a Hangout with some of the senior teachers from the Art of Living Foundation. So we have many different beautiful Hangouts coming up. So please watch out for us and join us in having a very successful International Yoga Day event. OVBI is bringing together many different organizations to have International Yoga Day events in 100 cities across the US. So please do join us. intyogaday.com is the website. Thanks a lot. Namaste, everybody.
Namaste.